the next teaching unit in the chapter Electrical Properties of a Solar Cell. This unit deals with the test conditions under which the parameters of solar cells are determined. You will also learn about solar simulators, which are often used for this purpose. We have seen in the last learning unit that the JV characteristic, and thus the parameters with which we describe the electrical behavior of a solar cell, depend on the irradiance and the temperature. Thus, in order to compare different solar cells or modules, their parameters must be measured under the same conditions. Therefore, globally uniform standard conditions have been defined under which the parameters of a solar cell are measured. We'll now take a closer look at these so-called standard test conditions, which are briefly referred to as STC. First, the STC contain a specification for the spectrum and the irradiance of the light source. Ideally, the solar cell would be irradiated with sunlight. However, since the irradiance and the spectrum of sunlight are subject to strong fluctuations, artificial light sources are usually used to meet the STC. The STC are based on the irradiance and light spectrum of the sun on a clear summer day. The spectrum specified here is the AM1.5 spectrum. To understand what is meant by AM1.5, let's take a closer look at the Earth from the outside. The Sun emits light with a certain spectral distribution, which is mainly determined by its surface temperature. This light hits the Earth's atmosphere in space. As it passes through the Earth's atmosphere, the solar radiation is absorbed to a greater or lesser extent, depending on the wavelengths. The spectrum of the solar radiation is thereby massively changed. The longer the path of the light through the atmosphere, the stronger the change. To describe the path length through the atmosphere, the air mass AM is defined. It is the ratio of the actual path length of the light to the shortest possible path. Outside the Earth's atmosphere, the spectrum is still unchanged. It is called AM0 spectrum. Sunlight travels the shortest possible path when the sun is exactly perpendicular to the sky, that is, at the zenith. In this case, the air mass is exactly 1. In latitude north or south of the Tropic of Capricorn, that is, from 23.5 north and south of the equator, however, the case of the sun being exactly at the zenith does not occur throughout the year. Here, the sun is much lower in the sky, even the summer months, which leads to a higher air mass and thus to a stronger attenuation of solar radiation. In addition, the air mass varies during the course of the day, so that over the entire year, the air mass is significantly greater than AM1. Therefore, an air mass of 1.5 has been agreed upon as a standard value for the STC. At this air mass, the sunlight hits the air surface at an angle of 41.8 degrees. Let's take a quick look at the spectral distribution of sunlight. As you probably know, sunlight consists of light of different wavelengths. The spectrum describes the intensity of the light independent of the wavelengths. Shown here is the spectrum of sunlight in space, that is, under AM0 conditions. The spectrum has the highest intensity in the visible range. However, the entire spectrum of sunlight extends over a much larger range, starting in the ultraviolet and extending far into the infrared. Now, as it passes through the atmosphere, the spectrum changes. Some wavelengths are almost completely absorbed, others are more or less attenuated. We will deal with the process behind this in detail later. At this point, it is only important for us which spectrum results on the Earth's surface. Shown here is the spectrum that can be measured on the Earth's surface on a clear day under AM1.5 conditions. This spectrum is called AM1.5 spectrum. The second specification for the STC refers to the irradiance. Similar to the spectrum, the irradiance depends strongly on the attenuation in the atmosphere. For the STC, an irradiance of 1000 watt per square meter is defined as the default value. This corresponds approximately to the irradiance on a clear summer day at northern or southern latitude, hence outside the tropics. The third condition of STC refers to self-temperature. Under STC, this must be 25 degrees Celsius. You can see here a list of all the STC specifications. For solar modules, the electrical parameters under STC are usually specified in the data sheet. This allows a comparison of different solar modules with each other. For most solar modules, however, the environmental conditions in reality are different from STC. In most countries, the irradiation is lower than 1000 watt per square meter most of the time. In addition, even good solar modules heat up during normal operation. How much a module heats up depends largely on the module design and the back ventilation. However, as we have seen, temperature has a major influence on the performance of a solar module. As a reminder, when the temperature rises by 10 degrees, the output of a solar module decreases by about 4 to 5% of the rated output power. Therefore, the temperature that occurs under normal operating condition is of great importance. According to the English term normal operating cell temperature, this temperature is called NOCT. The NOCT is measured using a set of test conditions that differ from STC. Under NOCT conditions, the irradiance is 800 watt per square meter and the spectrum is AM1.5 as for STC. However, the temperature is not specified as the cell temperature, but as the ambient temperature. This must be 20 degrees Celsius. Since the wind speed also has an effect on the heating of the module, this is also specified with 1 meter per second, which correspond to a rather light wind. In addition, the module must be rear ventilated for this test. That is, the wind also reaches the back of the solar module. With the NOCT, one knows the temperature of a specific module that occurs under the condition just mentioned. Typical NOCTs of solar modules are around 48 degrees Celsius with extreme values between 33 degrees Celsius and 58 degrees Celsius. In reality, however, both the irradiance and the ambient temperature vary. Therefore, it is also of interest what the temperature is on a particular hot summer day, for example, or a cold winter day. To calculate this temperature, the formula shown here can be used. You can see that in addition to the ambient and NOCT temperatures, the irradiance is also included in the calculation. This is because a solar cell delivers larger power with higher irradiance and heats up due to the corresponding thermalization losses in the solar cell. We have now become acquainted with two sets of test conditions under which the solar cell parameters can be determined. But how are the solar cell parameters determined in laboratory practice? In principle, it is of course possible to determine the desired parameters in outdoor tests and wait for suitable environmental conditions. Sometimes you have to wait quite long. However, these measurements usually have to be corrected due to heating of the modules and deviations from the test conditions and are thus subject to errors. Therefore, in practice, solar simulators are usually used to determine solar cell or solar module parameters. In general, solar simulators have to fulfill several requirements. Firstly, the radiation of the solar simulator must correspond to the AM1.5 reference spectrum as far as possible over several wavelengths range. The light source used in solar simulators are predominantly xenon arc lamps, but also more and more LED lamps are used. The xenon arc lamps have a good match with the AM1.5 spectrum. Shown here is the AM1.5 spectrum and the spectrum of a xenon arc lamp. To classify the spectral deviation, the deviation of the solar simulator spectrum from the AM1.5 spectrum in different wavelength ranges is considered. In the individual wavelength ranges, deviations upwards here in light blue or downwards here in dark blue are added up, and the deviations is given in percent. We also speak of the so-called spectral mismatch. In this way, six different wavelength ranges are analyzed. Without filtering, there's a deviation of over 50% in the infrared range. Therefore, the light of xenon arc lamps is often additionally filtered. Generally, solar simulators are divided into three classes for classification. Class A represents the highest quality class. In this class, the deviation must not exceed 25% in any wavelength range. Besides the spectral deviation, the spatial uniformity of the irradiance is important for the classification of a simulator. In class A, the irradiance must not vary by more than 2% over the area of the solar module. As a third point, the temporal stability of the irradiance plays a decisive role, as the irradiance may only fluctuate minimally for the duration of the measurement. A simulator receives an A classification in all three classes is a class AAA simulator. The simplest design of a solar simulator is a steady-state simulator. In this case, the solar cell or the solar module is permanently irradiated. The permanent irradiation causes a comparatively high power consumption. In addition, the module or the cell heats up, so cooling is necessary for these simulators. Steady state simulators are mainly used for the characterization of solar cells, which have a longer response time. In addition, they are also suitable, for example, for investigating the light aging behavior of solar cells or modules. To avoid heating of the solar cell or module, flash simulators are used. Instead of continuous illumination, these simulators work with a short flash lasting a few milliseconds. It is technically challenging to obtain reproducible intensities and spectra from one flash to another. On the other hand, the modules do not heat up, so there is no need for cooling. Let us summarize this learning unit. To characterize solar cells and modules, the standard test conditions, STC, are defined, which give specifications for irradiance, light spectrum, and cell temperature. To describe the behavior of solar modules under normal operating conditions, a second set of test conditions is used. With the NOCT, the normal operating cell temperature, it is possible to calculate the module temperature under any environmental conditions. Today, the parameters of solar cells and modules under STC are usually determined with the help of a flasher. Thank you for your attention.